Hi, everybody. Welcome to RDA Tech Q&A. You've got questions. We've got guesses. This is where we answer questions from you guys, maybe help you out with some technical issues. I'm Nash. I do radio.air. I've got over a decade's worth of experience in the tech field. Along with me tonight is my producer, Mike Gearman. He has a whole fuck bunch of pushing buttons and fiddly-witty things.
And writing code and things like that.
Well, yeah, but fiddly-ditty things.
Yes.
That's the technical term for it.
Don't send in code questions. I don't want to answer those.
You open the door. You open the door. It's your problem now. if you have questions for Mike and myself, go ahead and send those to requests@radio.air. Put tech Q&A in the subject line. We'll attempt to figure stuff out for you. But before we get to your question tonight, I've been waiting over a week to talk about this shit.
I'm guessing, I'm pretty sure I know which story this is.
I am so hungry.
And before you say what it is, I'm just going to start with, that word does not mean what they think it means.
Fucking God, mother. Yes, kids, we're talking, of course, about the iPhone 7. Courage! No, that's not courage.
No, that word, as Inigo Montoya said, I do not think that word means what you think it means. It is not courage to do away with an interface that everyone has all the gear for already, to make them buy another $150 piece of gear that you can lose in your couch like that.
The big story that came, and this is the astonishing part. The big story that came out of the iPhone 7 reveal was not any actual innovation on Apple's part.
Unless you count that each one comes preloaded with a fragment of the soul of Steve Jobs.
The new iPhone 7 was at best an incremental upgrade. No huge...
slightly better processor, probably a slightly better camera.
Also, they have removed the home button and replaced it with a vibrator.
I thought that was going to be for the iPhone 8.
It's for the 8. I thought it was the iPhone 7.
But I don't know. I still have this piece of this chunky thing for work, I think it's an iPhone 5. I'm not sure.
But the bottom line is there was little to no performance upgrades, little to no any big... They've capped the bottom of the line now from 16 gigabytes to 32 gigabytes.
Which is nice. You know, memories, extra memory is always good.
But that's not really an innovation or an upgrade. That's just they're not making a 16 gigabyte one anymore.
Well, yeah, because it simplifies the production line.
But the big news was not what Apple added, but what they took away, which is, of course, the 3.5-millimeter headphone jack. Apple had the audacity, marketing chief Phil Schiller. What a name.
What was his name?
Phil Schiller.
Ooh.
The marketing guy is actually named Schiller. I mean.
You know, it's like a dentist named Toothman. You have a name like that, you've got to go into marketing or PR.
I mean,
it's not the worst name out there. I still think that's Harry Paratestes. That is an actual person in Columbia, South Carolina. I'm not lying.
How did he survive grade school?
I don't know. Probably the same way Dick Butkus did, by just beating the crap out of anyone who made fun of his name. But yes, so they put out this, they get rid of the headphone jack, and they basically say, you have these new headphones, which just hang in your ears. Okay, which is going to be a problem for joggers until they have the clip-on ear ones.
Right.
And they sync up. And here's the best part of how they sync up. You actually have to have an iCloud account. You can't just go, I'm going to hook these in and just push a button and done. Now, once you sync through your iCloud account to the device, to my understanding, they don't have to continually talk to iCloud. So, you know, if you're in a signal dead area, your headphones don't stop working. They just, you know,
but
they're cat toys too. I mean, they're small enough. You're going to lose them in the couch. Yep. You're going to be jogging. They're going to fall out. You're going to go, oh, that fell down. Oh, great. Now it's gone.
Whereas and if they only have a 5-hour charge.
Yes.
And they're $150.
Yes. They're small little pieces of plastic and $150. And the batteries are not user replaceable.
No. Nope.
So when they start to fail to charge.
Not which if.
When. Which I would suspect we're going to start hearing about the first cases of bad battery sets within the next 6 months. There'll be someone who just, some subset of the line that will just be bad batteries, and Apple will have the same sort of response to the flexible screen losing touch capacitance. They'll go, oh, well, you've just got to buy new ones. That's my guess. Unless someone important or popular has theirs go, and then they'll go, oh, we'll refund those and maybe set a new policy. I'm a little cynical.
Yeah, a little bit. And you have every reason to be, because this is...
Apple.
Yeah, it's kind of bullshit. Now, what is... It's just... What's making this just appalling is not only did they remove the headphone jack.
Right.
But now we're on a lightning connector. Not right. USB-C. That would have been courageous. If Apple had said the iPhone 7 is ditching Lightning and going with an industry standard USB-C, I would have been a little mollified.
But of course they can't, because then they can't sell you
the
various sets of dongles.
We're getting there.
Yeah.
They do include in the box an iPhone 7 Lightning headphone and an iPhone 7 3.5mm to lightning jack adapter.
However, what they don't include is a splitter so you can charge your phone and use your headphones at the same time.
Yes, because now the charging port and the headphone port are the same port.
Yes. However, Belkin, the company that regularly produces overpriced dongles, has already released an overpriced dongle that will do both. You can split
it. Yeah, it's a splitter. You can listen to your headphones and you can charge it. And you know how much that's going to cost you?
Probably $40.
Another $40 fucking dollars to be able to charge. And not only that, not only is it an extra $40 to charge your phone while you're using your headphones, but you have to connect. It's not a headphone jack and a lightning jack. No, it's two lightning jacks. So in order for it to work, you have to plug in one dongle that splits the first port into two ports. Then you have to connect another dongle that turns the lightning jack into a headphone port. So you have two dongles trailing off your fucking iPhone.
Yep. It's extra things to lose is what it is. And that's really all that they're going to make. I mean, what's going to happen over the next 6 months is every mid to high range hotel is going to have a number of these dongles in their lost and found drawer, where if you're polite to the hotel staff, they'll go, oh, yeah, we got a spare one of those.
Yeah.
And if you're not, they won't admit it. Tons of chargers. I guarantee every hotel has them.
If you lose the adapter, the one that comes in the box, Apple will be happy to sell you a new one. We just don't know how much it'll be. But it's not going to be free.
Oh, no, of course not.
Now, the other nasty thing about using a Lightning port as opposed to USB-C is now every headphone and speaker wired connection accessory for the iPhone 7 has to include a Lightning port.
Yep.
And Lightning is a proprietary standard owned by Apple.
Yep.
Meaning every one of those devices has a higher price tacked on. That's the Apple fee. Apple gets a piece of every accessory with a Lightning adapter sold to it. Why are they doing this?
Because they like money.
Well, all right. Let me lay it out here for you. It could be their stated position is the 3.5 millimeter jack is ancient, and by getting rid of it, we are forcing the industry to move forward. Which again, if they had switched to USB-C, I could almost buy that. But here's my take on it. If you look at year-to-year sales on iPhones, they've kind of flatlined. Now, I don't mean flatline as in they've died. I mean sales are flat. They're leveled off. These are the kind of sales you see on commoditized goods. Yes. Like refrigerators and televisions and desktop computers. Stuff that people get and intend to keep and don't replace very often. All smartphone sales have pretty much, not just the iPhone, but all of them.
Yeah, we've hit a plateau on capability until someone comes out with something new.
Which,
I don't know, 3D picture camera built into the phone. Well, possible, I suppose.
If you're a sensible, sane person who thinks...
Hold on, Nash.
Yeah.
You said sensible and sane, and we're talking about people who buy Apple products.
Well, yeah.
We're going to get hate mail on that one.
Normal people...
You're going to get hate mail on that one. They don't know my address.
Most laymen regard businesses as, well, if the business is making money, what's the problem? The problem is short-term quarterly growth.
Yes.
What this does and what this has been doing for a very long time, and it shows up obviously in so many problem areas of our economy, is companies are pushed to increase profits every quarter.
Yes. Oh, I've seen this. Let me give a non-tech example. At Carolina, the university I went to, they added a restaurant to the food court. It was a Chinese food place. It was packed the first semester. It was still packed the second and third semester. But it leveled off. Hmm. And so the Chinese food place said, because it was a chain, said, you know what? We're not seeing growth. We're out of here. The fact they're making money hand over fist didn't matter. They weren't seeing growth.
Growth, and that's the problem is you have all these shareholders who want to see their shares expand, and they're steering the will of the company. It's not a matter of making money, it's a matter of making shareholder money. So since iPhone sales have plateaued, they're not getting any extra growth there. The way they can get growth is accessories. If you have to buy all your accessories again, and each one of them is licensed by Apple, Apple gets income off of these accessories. Now, there's nothing that proves this, obviously. This is just my personal take on it.
And it's a reasonable thing. By the way, I looked at the price of the... Apple has the Lightning 2 3.5 millimeter jack adapter on their site already.
$9. $9. So, and that's not with a head... That's not for a set of headphones, which I will say, I've got these nice shoelace headphones, which, again, Apple doesn't offer these. Which they should, because the great thing about these shoelace headphones that I have when I go out is they don't tangle. That you could curl these up in your pocket and just let them drop. They don't tangle up. They're great. I love these things.
I'll have to look into those, but I have.
Apple doesn't make those.
So Apple gets no money off of them.
Right.
And there's no proprietary thing on them, at least as far as Apple's concerned.
Right.
There might be something in the speakers that's a little proprietary for someone else.
Yeah. But Apple doesn't make money off those. But they do make money off that adapter.
Yep.
So everybody's got to have one of those adapter, and you are going to lose that fucking adapter because it's only like this. I have a similar adapter for my my Android phone, but it's a special one. It's a USB adapter. It lets me plug in flash drives and pretty much any USB. I could plug in a mouse to my phone if I wanted, a regular USB mouse. It's about this long. And when I ordered it, I got three of them because I knew I was going to lose the motherfuckers. I already lost one already.
And one will become a cat toy eventually.
Eventually. Also, people are talking about the Square and PayPal 3.5 millimeter adapters. Have you seen these when vendors... they use these little adapters that plug into the 3.5 millimeter.
Oh, yeah,
jack.
Yeah. So you can run your PayPal off of your phone.
You're going to have to replace that. I don't know if that'll work across a Lightning adapter.
Okay. Technically speaking, I can think of no reason why it wouldn't.
But
however, the convenience of the way it worked before is it plugged in and was seated right there on the phone. Mm-hmm. It wasn't just hanging loose in the breeze.
Dangle, dongle, dongle, dongle. Yeah. This is... We're going to have to see how well the iPhone 7 sells to see if it'll catch on. Because right now, performance of the iPhone 6, which is now cheaper than the iPhone 7, the 6S, and the iPhone 7 are about dead even. People have to decide if they want the innovation of losing a headphone jack. That's it.
There'll be a certain percentage that buy it just because they got to have the latest and greatest Apple thing. If they're smart, they'll keep their old Apple thing when they go, huh, this wasn't as cool. And Apple, I suspect, will lose a few of their fanboys over this.
When Apple did get rid... Apple did something similar to this many years ago with the iMac.
Was this when they got rid of the CDs and DVD drives?
Well, they got rid of the floppy drive. When the first Apple iMac premiered, that was the Bondi Blue iMac in 1996, and Apple did what was considered a bold move in the industry at the time, which was discarding the 3.5 millimeter. Hey, whoa, that's weird. 3.5 floppy, 3.5 inch floppy, 3.5 millimeter jack. Whoa, spooky. Apple got rid of the 3.5 inch floppy
floppy drive.
Yeah.
The difference there, though, there was already other dry media types out there.
Yeah.
Hard drives were becoming cheaper. CDs and DVDs, very popular. You had zip disks.
There was also initial cloud storage began because of that. Cloud storage sort of began as a thing because Apple got rid of the 3.5-inch floppy.
And the 3.5, it was the right time probably to get rid of it.
Right, because there were better alternatives available. There is no performance benefit to a Lightning connector over this.
There is the benefit of digital rights management, because everything will now be a digital transmission, though that Lightning to 3.5 should be a digital to audio conversion. Digital to analog conversion, rather.
This is exactly the same thing as the Lightning adapter, except the Lightning adapter, instead of having this bit on the end, it's the same wires, the same types of speakers, the same microphone. It just hacks this off and takes these little wires, which all this is essentially a bare wire.
Yes.
That's what a 3.5 millimeter, it's essentially a bare wire.
And it's such low voltage and current that it doesn't shock you. Well, it does, but you don't feel it.
Yeah, this you plug this in and it completes the circuit. It's just taking this off and replacing it with the other one. It offers no hardware audio benefit. You're already getting digital audio out of these things. It's already transmitting digital audio. There is, from here up, there's no difference. It's just a wire. So yep. There's no performance increase. And by going wireless, you actually introduce lag and latency potential and interference issues sometimes.
Yeah.
With wireless headphones, so you're actually losing audio fidelity
by going wireless. And here's the other thing. When I plugged my headphones into my phones over the years, I have occasionally been working at a desk, and I have my phone there, headphones right to me, and I get up and walk away, and my phone pulls off the desk and comes with me. I'm like, oh, yeah, I need to grab my phone. With this, I can walk away from my phone and forget about it because I'll still have signal for probably a good 50 feet.
Yeah.
Which is long enough if you do this in, say, a Starbucks. You know, it's far enough. Someone goes, he left his phone. I've got a phone.
So, yeah. I could be completely wrong here. I'll be the first to admit if I'm wrong. But I don't think this is going to catch on. I think if Android phones mimic this, it's going to be the USB-C jack. If we do go that way, which I could live with, because that's universal, it's something that everything's going to have available, and the accessories for it are going to be considerably cheaper, available for everyone. Yep. So I'm not, however, the only downside there is that we're going to have dongles again.
And I think there'll be, because it's Android, there'll be some fun, there'll be, what'll happen is the phone manufacturers for Android will go, we're going to have one phone out of the product line that does this as a trial. Mm. And if it sells really well, we'll shift everything over. And if it doesn't, we won't.
I bet you anything the Android phones are going to have two jacks on them. Two USB-C jacks. One for the charging, one for the headphones. They're looking at what Apple's doing, and they're going to say, okay, we're going to make these changes, but, you know.
We're going to make it more useful.
Yeah. This is...
And maybe the iPhone 7.5 will have two lightning jacks on it.
Fuck lightning. This is the same thing that happened with FireWire, by the way. FireWire was Apple's precursor to USB. And they thought, everyone's going to use FireWire. It'll be perfect. And you can have hubs and daisy chains. And you'll all pay us for a license. And everyone else said, yeah, we're just going to make USB.
Because it's a consortium there. And the license fees are far lower.
We're going
to
make...
Or being split multiple ways. And some of it comes back to us.
And then there was... We're going to make Thunderbolt, and it's going to be better than USB, and everyone's going to use Thunderbolt on their computers, and we'll get a license fee. Yeah, we're making USB 3.0.
And unlike USB 3.0, Thunderbolt can start fires.
USB 3.0, backward compatible. So, yeah, it's Apple's not had a good track record with their proprietary connectors. Ever. Ever. So, anyway, we're running out of time, so we'll only do one more story here before we get to questions. Let's talk, not to let Android...
When we get going on Apple, we get going on Apple.
Fucking fuck. Not to take any fire away from Android this week. I guess this isn't really just... this is kind of a general thing, and it's a bothersome trend that I'm starting to see with apps now. And it should concern everyone. Pokemon Go, the latest update for Pokemon Go, if you happen to have rooted or jailbroken your iPhone, you can't play Pokemon no more.
Is it just iPhones or is it Android?
Android as well. If you've rooted or jailbroken your phone, you cannot play Pokemon anymore. The reason they did this was... All right, let's break this down, at least on the Android side. What rooting means is you're giving yourself admin control over your phone.
Over your own device. Now, most other computing devices you own, with the possible exception of your PlayStation or things like that, I say possible because there's ways there too, you have, at least in theory, even if you don't use it, admin access on those things.
You can do whatever you want, mostly with Windows, with Linux, you can do whatever the goddamn hell you want. But hardware you own and software you have a license to, you can do whatever the fuck you want, as long as you have admin rights. Admin rights allows the computer to do things like delete certain files that would be protected otherwise, and have access to permissions within the system, and adjust certain files that...
Or, more importantly, for a lot of people who root phones, delete the crapware that is preloaded on a phone. The apps that say, no, this is a system app, you can't delete this. I go, well, I don't want the NFL app.
Yeah.
It's not system app.
No.
It's
bullshit. It's taking up space on my phone. Another valid reason to root, the reason I've done it, is one, I have access to neat little customizations on my phone to make it look nicer. That's a fun one. But a practical one is, I mentioned earlier, I have a USB adapter for my phone that lets me run flash drives, USB hard disks. I can access them through my phone, just like if they were a regular disk. It's a very useful feature, especially considering, you know, you start running up on space considerations on your phone, and you don't want to upload everything to the cloud, and then I tell you, using Google Drive is a pain in the ass, because the download feature is not readily available. You have to dig to find a way to make your files available offline. I just prefer just to copy them over. Boom, boom, zip, zap, done.
Yep.
And that program requires root access for me to be able to copy files via USB to my phone.
Yeah, it didn't used to. It used to be for Android phones, you could copy files. You plug it into your computer, you copy the file over, you're done.
Yeah, but this is
they specific. Took that functionality away for some reason.
No, this is specifically for the USB. You still have that functionality in jail, but this is specifically for the USB. Just a flash drive out of my pocket, boom, and I can leave it attached. So I could just switch out my storage because most phones these days don't have SD cards anymore.
The 7 Edge does.
That's a Samsung. No Samsung. Samsung bad. But why is this a problem? Why is Pokemon Go, for one thing, all of these people who already had rooted devices when it started now can't access their accounts anymore?
Yeah, and if they'd paid for any features in the game, now they're out money.
Yep,
that money if they go, oh, I'm going to buy a bunch of stuff, you know, and, oh, well, there's an update, and now I can't get my stuff.
In order to unroot your phone, depending on the make and model, it can be anywhere as easy as a simple application or flashing the entire ROM over again. It all depends. Yeah.
Which means, of course, downloading all your apps again.
Yeah, pretty much you have to reset your phone back to start. And now people have been saying, well, there's this program you can download that can hide the fact your phone is rooted, and you just put it on there and set it up, and it's fine. Well, ostensibly the reason Niantic removed the root option for Pokemon Go, removed the root Pokemon Go being able to play it on root devices, is because scammers and cheaters and bots were making use of programs that spoofed the GPS address to make it look like the phone was someplace else. But if I can simply download a program that bypasses the root detection, what was the fucking point?
And I'll say that, you know, Niantic did, you know, something similar with their previous game, Ingress, where if it detected GPS spoofing programs, there's only a finite number of them, it would say, oh, I can't do this. You're using a GPS spoofing program. Now, would it stop someone from rolling their own GPS spoofing program and, you know, changing the name slightly so it wasn't detected? Yeah, it's a moving target. But They'd handled it before without blocking mass numbers of people.
Yeah. Well, and I heard a lot of complaints about this on Twitter that Niantic's a small company, so why should go easy on them? You've got the Pokemon Go license. You've got the arguably the largest mobile game in the world. Hire more motherfuckers! If you can't afford to hire more motherfuckers, you got a problem in your management, because you got the biggest goddamn game in the goddamn world on mobile. The other argument, again, was just download it. It's fine. Just do. No. I don't know who made this program. It's not on the App Store.
It's not on the Play Store. It's not gonna be something that can be on the Play Store. Google will say, no, you can't have that.
I don't know these people. I don't trust this root detection spoofer. I don't trust it. I'm not going to potentially fuck up my phone so I can play this game, and in theory, if they come up with a way to detect that I'm spoofing root detection, they might ban me. So, what the fuck? The bad precedent this sets here is it's trying to push Android users in particular. Apple are already used to this, but it's trying to push Android users into the walled garden, meaning a rooted device does not have access to certain other things, like being able to install certain apps, being able to have complete control of its system, being able to do everything that a computer should be able to do. And that leads to things like, well, hey, you want to do this thing on your phone, buy this $5 app. Well, if I rooted it, I could just do that anyway for free. No, 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 we're not letting you root shit no more. Buy the $5 fucking app. And that's, yep, that is concerning. If this is supposed to be the post-PC era, no, this is not a PC anymore. This is a toy. And it's not a viable alternative to a desktop computer that we're used to. I mean, imagine if Steam released a game, you played it for 2 months, and then Steam said, wait, you've got admin privileges on your Windows computer. You can't play this game anymore. Why? Because you might cheat. We've other games, everything from Blizzard to Funcom to Valve, all of these games have had cheating forever.
Yeah.
But they don't ban Windows operating system admin rights. They ban the fucking cheaters. So I don't trust the reasoning behind this.
And you know, it may be someone above Niantic. It may be, you know, the people who own Pokemon.
Some people were theorizing pushing that this was Nintendo because they want to be damn certain they get that they get their microtransaction money out of this.
Yeah,
I don't know.
And if it is, you know, I suspect there's something where Niantic can't say, no, this is a Nintendo requirement we had to put in.
But it is a bad precedent because this is, like we said, the biggest mobile game in the world currently. And by using such a big platform to get people used to the idea of you can't do this if you're rooted, it's shoving slowly, pushing the industry toward that area of toward that walled garden, and no, that's unacceptable. That's I was enjoying Pokemon Go, but now nope, I'm no Pokemon no more. No more Pokemon. Fuck you guys, assholes. I'm not fucking up my phone just to play this game. No. Anyway, well, that's enough bitching out of me this week. Man, I was just a big list of me. You know what grinds my gears? That was me this week.
What's that line?
It's Family Guy. You got me quoting fucking Family Guy. God damn it. All right.
It's when we've got him quoting Big Bang Theory that we know things have gone south.
All right. Well, now it's time for us to answer your questions. If you have questions, tech shit you need help with, send those to me and Mike at request@radiodeadair.com. Put tech Q&A in the subject line. We'll attempt to help you. First one comes from Diego. He says, hello, Nash, Mike, Grady, and Mike's animal companions, if any. Do you have
any? No. If I ever get my own place again, then yes, I will have a cat.
Are you sure you don't have any? How good's your exterminator?
Well, okay, there's probably a spider in the house somewhere.
All right. Hello, Mike Spider. I come to you with a simple HDMI question. Due to my trio of consoles, mini PC and occasional laptop, my TV has run out of HDMI ports to connect all of these. It only has two. So before I buy a $15 HDMI splitter from Amazon, I want to know, is there any type of HDMI standard I should be looking for? Yes. We're not, even with the 4K, which requires, I believe, HDMI 2.1 or 2.2.
2.
What are we up to?
I want to say 2.1, but yeah.
2.1. HDMI has iterations and standards, kind of like USB. Remember USB 1, USB 2, USB 3? HDMI has those as well. Normally, they don't require much of an upgrade in terms of your cables. The cables will have worked fine because they're just wires connected to connectors. But the software on the devices and the firmware on the devices has to be... It's not like you can plug in a USB 1 device into a USB 2... Well, actually, it is exactly like that. If you plug in a USB 1 device into a USB 2.0 slot, it only goes up to USB 1 speed. It can't go as fast as USB 2.0, but it does work. Same with HDMI. What were you going to say?
I was going to say it's version 2 allows 4K at 60 frames per second.
Okay. So even if you're not even concerned about version 2, most things coming out these days have HDMI 2 because they're new, they're up to date. But if your TV isn't 4K, and it is probably most TVs, I think, are still at around HDMI 1.4 or 1.5 somewhere.
1.4 was the last one series, yeah.
Yeah. So that part of it doesn't really, you know, that's you can't change what's on your TV. You don't really have to worry about that much. Any new device you get will work with your old device. That's okay, but what you do have to be concerned about is something called HDCP. This is the aspect of HDMI that is shit. It's the DRM aspect, which is a pain in the fucking ass. It's what control... When HDMI was coming out, the consortium that was behind it decided that there had to be some sort of piracy control built into HDMI.
Yeah, and the reason they wanted this was because HDMI is such a generally crisp, clear signal that they go, oh, well, if someone's just bringing this in, it'd be really easy for them to pirate this and have a nice, clean, pirated image. Because if you look... if you ever looked at many pirated streams, you know, video recordings, whatever, many of them are crap.
Yeah, but a lot are pretty good.
And HDCP says, hey, HDCP says, hey, you can't, we've detected that there's something here that's trying to record. We're going to downgrade to crap.
Right. It's the firewall that stands between certain devices that are not HDCP certified from working with HDMI. And this includes HDMI splitters. Some of them are HDCP compatible. Some of them are not.
Yes, price and long cables. Yeah, long cables, by the way, also can cause HDCP issues because the signal for HDCP is not very strong and a long cable will make it have enough resistance in it to make it screwy. So it went for a splitter, whatever, you can make sure it's HDCP compatible / certified, whatever word they use on there.
I will point out that HDCP has not stopped a damn person from being able to copy HDMI signals because there are ways around it. Very simple ones. So it was a big waste of time and money on everybody's part. All it has done now these days is frustrate consumers who are trying to do simple things like get HDMI splitters for their fucking television sets. A cheap splitter or a splitter that doesn't have HDCP, you could plug in your console to it and your console won't work on your television because it's failed the HDCP check through that splitter. So you have to make sure whichever splitter you get, please verify that it has HDCP. If you're looking on Amazon, check the reviews. Someone will mention if it is or it isn't.
Or it'll be in the description. For example, I'm looking at one on Amazon right now. I just typed in HDMI splitter HDCP, and it was the first Amazon link I saw. And it's a $21 device.
Right.
And it says HDMI 1.3. Maybe you're looking for 1.4. You know, I would. But it has HDCP 1, 1.1, 1.2, which I think is all three versions of HDCP. I don't think there's a version past that, but don't quote me on that until I've finished clicking. No, there's an HDBC 2.1 and 2.2.
For 4K, presumably.
Probably.
So it's a great big pain in everybody's butt. Hooray! So, yeah. Next up, let's see. William has a simple one, but it's going to be a bit of a complicated answer. William.
Okay.
William says, what kind of microphone do you recommend for someone who's strapped for cash but still wants something that's not crap? We have two answers here. We have the quick and fast one and the longer bit.
Well, part of it's going to depend on what... I mean, if you're asking us, I'm assuming you're asking about a microphone for I'm going to be doing gaming and I want to be able to talk to my friends on Skype or Discord or whatever app you're using for your to coordinate your event. Or you're doing podcast type things. And you're not getting a microphone for your drum set or something like that.
My stock answer for this hasn't changed much over the years, and that's been he wants it for gaming. Well, gaming, I look at gaming headsets because those are kind of made that way. But understand, pretty much every gaming headset mic you're gonna get is gonna be shit. They're not made for fidelity. They're made to just work.
Yeah, but the advantage is they're relatively inexpensive compared to, say, a cardioid mic.
Unless
you want the Razer brand where you've got all the bells and whistles and everything and it glows and has changeable lights and things.
Yeah, I do get asked this one a lot, and if you're doing it for recording purposes, my stock answer is usually the Blue Snowball. It's cheap, it works, it's simple, it's a USB plug, boom, you're done.
And it's a really solid mic.
It's not great. It's not the best. And I have my own preference. If you can, the Blue Snowball is about $50, maybe cheaper, depending on where you find it. If you can, I would set aside the money for about $150. You can put together the beginnings of a recording setup that at $150, and I'm talking mic and USB mixer. At that $150, you have something that is modular. You can improve the mic later. You can improve the stuff. It'll spread out over time. And $150 is the ground floor in getting in, and it's pretty worthwhile. But
now, and if I may say something,
go ahead.
Presonus, which is an audio company, has a studio kit, headphones, a fairly decent mic. And an audio box mixer set up for $225. If you ever think I'm going to go into podcasting, that might be something to look into. But
I don't recommend those little audio interface boxes. I don't. Because normally they have one control on them. Volume.
That's Oh, no, this one has several.
Does this one have a full three-band EQ?
It does not have a full three-band EQ.
That's
it
the thing. USB mixers are about the same price as those audio interface boxes for cardioid powered microphones. They're about the same price, but they have so many more features. They have multiple channels and they have a full EQ on them. They're a better value. They're bigger, but they're better value.
I think this has EQ software built in. You know, you can bring
bullshit. Bullshit with the software. Give me knobs. Give me fucking. But the longer answer beyond this is, especially for recording, you could have the greatest mic in the world with the fantastic super setup and tube preamps and just beautiful. But if you do not have a good recording environment, that isn't going to mean shit. You've got to be able to keep your noise level low, reverb down to a minimum, and most empty rooms, even this room, gives me some reverb problems sometimes.
Yeah. Because unless you want to sound like a shitty band, in which case, who cares about reverb?
You have to, you have to be concerned about audio hiss, your air conditioning unit. That's where a good noise gate comes in handy. Noise gate is a simple little device that if anything is below a certain level of decibels, it doesn't get recorded. It just doesn't go through anything above it. So it'll filter out stuff like air conditioner noise and other things. Your environment matters a lot in your recording, more than anything else, really, when it comes to recording audio. If you have great audio hardware, it'll record everything really great, including the sound of traffic going by and every little creak in your house and your AC going on and off and police sirens and that fucking motorcycle.
My train's going by.
The train. Fucking train. Yeah. So you have to make sure your environment for serious recording, your environment matters just as much, which is why if you get a blue snowball, you can get by okay. Just make sure you're recording in a good setting. And that will help with a ton of things.
But if you're just doing gaming, you know, a gaming headset with, built-in microphone, you know, and you can easily drop $250 in that if you want a name brand, like, you know, where it's name brand speakers in the headphones. But you can also, you know, pick up something, I think, fairly simple for around $50 or $60. Yeah. That'll do you for gaming.
That's about your price threshold right there, about $50 or $60. That sounds about right. That's about the price of a blue snowball. So either way, you'll be good. Heck, you could probably get a blue snowball and you wouldn't have to have, you'd be able to like put it nearby you and you wouldn't have to have the little flippy thing on your ear. And you wouldn't sound like you're coming out of an AM radio. That's what that's what most of those gaming headsets sound like. They all sound like old timey AM radio. That's what they fucking, they sound horrible. They sound like old telephones. Old wired telephone micro. They're shit. Let's do Ben's question.
Okay.
Ben says, I have a pretty quick question. My computer display looks a little smeared, like when you accidentally rub your hand over mostly dry ink while you're writing. You have any idea what might be causing that? Yes, Ben. It's called ghosting.
Well, they're just because I had to do this with someone in management last week, I just have to ask. Ben, is there a little sheet of plastic that's been on your monitor since forever that you can look in the corner and peel that off and go, oh, hey, everything's clear now? Ben, I'm sorry. You know, it's probably not there, but I have to ask.
Ghosting is...
Tell me I'm wrong. Nash, you've seen it too.
I have. Yes. God damn, I see those people who get all these electronics and leave all the plastic film all over the shit. And I'm like, that's not supposed to stay on there.
That is the one thing in tech that drives me nuts. I've walked into a server room. Switch has been in there for years, and there was still the little plastic peeling up at the corners, turning yellowish from age. Yep. I'm like, nope, this shit's coming off.
What ghosting is what happens when there's a signal issue between the two devices, your computer and your screen, that's interfering with what's coming out on the screen. Now, it could be a couple of different causes. Your first thing to check is your cables.
Yes. Check the cable connections to make sure they're connected firmly. If that does not make it go away, if you have another cable of the same type, try it.
Right.
Because it could just be the cable's gone south. I've seen a cable that did not transmit all the color signals properly, and so the screen had a nice purple shade to it. It was kind of, I would have wanted that cable, but you know.
What you need to do, the first step is unplug, take a can of compressed air, blast out your connections on both sides of the cable, both the plugs and the sockets for your video.
Because a tiny little bit of dust that you might not even see can cause a massive signal issue. Now, one thing you don't say, and I 99% certain it's not the issue. I'm almost certain you're using a flat panel of some sort. If for some reason it's an old CRT, you can have that sort of issue because the CRT has just gotten old, or it's been on too long in one configuration and it just images blur. But most people don't have those anymore, so it's probably not the issue.
No. So first thing we're gonna do is check the connections. Second thing we're gonna do is, if that doesn't work, switch to a new cable. Third, if that doesn't work, here's where we're gonna get a little bit dicey. You may need to find another device that will plug into that same kind of connector plug the monitor into something else and see if it's still doing it. If it is,
this will tell you it's the monitor itself.
Right. If it's still smearing when you plug it to a different computer, your monitor's going dead. And there's no fixing a monitor. There really is. The price of fixing a computer monitor is more than the price of buying a new one.
Right.
It's
the same thing with home printers, by the way. The price of fixing a home printer is usually more than the price of buying a new one.
If it stops doing it when you plug it into a new computer, then you have a problem.
It's your video out. Card.
Yeah. You may need to.
Now, one thing to check there, most video cards these days have multiple outputs.
Yeah.
Try a different output on the video card as well. If you were doing DVI to DVI, but you have an HDMI, and you said, oh, I just didn't want to drop $30 for an HDMI cable at the time, switch over to HDMI, see if it goes away.
Yeah.
Or alternately, because sometimes this does screwy things too. If your monitor has HDMI and DVI, but your computer only has DVI out or HDMI out, try an HDMI to DVI cable between them. See if the signal conversion makes it clear.
Yeah.
Sometimes it does. Just because, it's going, screw it, I'm losing. It might drop some information, not be the resolution, because DVI is better. But the information that's being dropped might be what's screwing up.
Now, there may be one circumstance here where you're out of luck. And you don't mention this in your question, but if you're using a laptop, there's nothing we can really do to help you. You're going to have to take it in to be serviced because everything is internal on the laptop. The cable is proprietary and special. It could be the monitor going. It could be that connection going, but there's nothing you can really access there yourself. You could, if you feel adventurous, if you don't normally do this sort of thing, I wouldn't recommend it. You're probably going to have to take it in to have it repaired. If it's a laptop, because there's no way around it. I'm very sorry. But hopefully that helped. Fingers crossed, maybe. Hopefully. So.
Yeah.
Let's see. Which one do I want to do now? We have about 10 minutes left. All right. Let's do Andrew's one at the bottom, because this is a fairly simple one. Hi Nash and Mike, my wife and I recently decided, due to various reasons, both immediate and pending, that we intend to move from our current location to a slightly larger city across the country. We are currently exploring options for transporting a lot of stuff. So far, the easiest and cheapest option is to ship the vast majority of stuff via U-Haul, U-Box. My question is, what advice do you guys have about preparing a computer for long-distance travel and shipping, particularly in a small cargo container like U-Box? Should the computer tower and its components be packed as a single unit, or is it better, safer, to disassemble the computer and stow each component in its own packing materials? Should I forget the whole shipping thing and just check the computer's baggage? Oh, God, no!
God, no.
Do not do that.
Yeah, for example, if you were to fly through LAX doing that, you won't have a computer when you get back. It'll just disappear.
Don't do that. Okay. This is one of those, and I'll tell you, when we were just moving, when I was in Minnesota helping Lewis move, he would not let anyone else touch his computers. He would not. He put them in the car with him, put a seatbelt on them. He wouldn't let anybody else touch the computers when we were moving them. And I don't fucking blame him, because for a lot of us, our computers end up being our livelihoods. Okay. If you built this yourself, what I always do when I build my own system is I save the box and I save the styrofoam.
Yeah.
It is reasonable. Not 100% here, but it's reasonable that you can pack your computer in the box the case came from with the styrofoam on it. Put it in another box, okay? And put some foam peanuts around that to give it an extra layer. And it should be okay.
Should. There'll be some people who will tell you if you leave the hard drives in there, this is where people get into a little bit of superstitious and a little screwing. There's some physics behind it, but how you should orient the box hard drive platters in the box. So personally, if you built it yourself, what I would do is remove the hard drive from the computer, package that separately, because everything else in the computer is probably gonna be fine moving across country in a U-Haul box. And you know, if you take, I don't know if I'd check the hard drive that you have in your carry-on luggage or not. They might look at you strange if you do that.
Well, I put a hard drive in my carry-on luggage, sure.
Okay.
You put it in what's called a static bag. It's a little electronic bag they make that's an anti-static device. You put it in there, seal it up, it should be fine. However, back the motherfucker up.
Yes.
Make sure you have a copy.
I'd back it up at least twice. I'd have two copies because the odds of all three going very low.
Yeah, I'm kind of paranoid about this shit.
And like I say, I'd image the machine to an external drive, possibly to DVD, depending on how big the system is. I would certainly put important data, family photos, etc., on a separate disk, just because your important data, your family photos, your tax information, you can probably fit all in one DVD, unless you just take tons of photos.
As for the other hardware, it depends on how big and bad your system is. This is how things have advanced, especially with video cards. They have large coolers on them, and even with two layers of foam around it, video card could rattle and maybe even fall out of its socket or damage itself. I would also perhaps maybe remove the video card. Now, I don't think you have to disassemble the entire computer, but video cards are kind of big. They have their own moving parts, and they could come out of the socket. If you weren't going to be around it, I'd take the video card out, again, put it in one of those static bags, and pack it separately. You don't have to fly with the video card. There's no sensitive information on the video card. But I would pack it securely and make sure it's in a where, it's not going to get squished away.
And just because I've moved across country before, label the box it's on so you can say video card. So when you're going, okay, well, I've got 9 boxes labeled kitchen. I put the video card in one of them for some reason.
Unless you have a massive cooler. Or a closed loop cooler or some sort of super unique one, you can probably leave the cooler, the CPU cooler in place and don't have to worry about it. RAM probably isn't going to rattle out of its slots, and the CPU isn't, because those are both locked down. They have locking mechanisms on them. And while the PCI slot has locking mechanisms on them, again, the video cards these days are just so much heavier and they have so much give to them. Even screwing it in place, it may not be sturdy. Now, this is only if you want to go this extra mile just to be safe. It's your call.
It used to be the case that, I want to say, Windows 95 had an option in there of, I am moving this computer physically a long distance. Yeah, it wasn't labeled this way, but there was an option where you could tell it, basically lock down the platters, but I don't think that exists anymore. I haven't seen it since probably, say, the 95 days or 98 days.
So yeah, the only components I would worry about removing would be your hard drive and your video card. If you have a big, super badass video card, I'd remove that.
And obviously, if you're water cooling your system, if it's you're doing your own water, roll your own, add water periodically, drain that before you move.
Yeah.
If it's self-contained water cooling, just make sure it's secure.
Yeah. The rest of it should be, the only parts you'd have to even worry about, the rest of it should be fine.
And the only other lesson I would say is, if you have pets, make sure that they're not in the U-Haul when you close it up.
What?
When I moved from my parents' house to the first apartment I had out of college, one of my parents' cats decided to hitch a ride. And we did not know until we opened up the back of the van there. And there she was, just sitting there going, that was a fun ride. And I didn't even piss on anything.
We tried
to convince my parents that we did not do this on purpose, but can we keep the cat? And they said no.
I think if this little bastard tried that, he'd lose his little mind. Yeah, you don't want to get in a U-Haul, do you?
Well, he...
Nope, he does not want to get in the U-Haul. All right, okay, there you go.
Some people are allergic to cats. Grady is allergic to Nash.
Well, that's going to be that's going to do it for us this week. We'll be back in 2 weeks. In the meanwhile, if you have questions for us, go ahead and send those to request@radiodeadair.com. We'll see if we maybe be able to help you guys out. In the meanwhile, for Mike and myself, this is Nash. We'll see you back here next time.
Yep. Yeah.